Hi everyone, welcome to NetGate Chemistry. So in the previous class we studied about the half cell, the types of electrode potentials, the representation of electrode potentials, and we were on the topic of some common reversible electrodes, in which we studied about metal-metal ion electrode, gas electrode, and today we are going to study the third type of electrode, which is your metal-insoluble metal salt electrode. Okay, so we'll first discuss about the construction of this type of electrode. So in this electrode, what we do, we take a metal plus a sparingly soluble salt of the same metal. Which we are going to immerse in a solution of soluble salt having same anion. So we are going to see this type of electrode with the help of an example. So we are going to discuss an example of this type of electrode, which is your calomel electrode. In calomel electrode, what we do, suppose we have taken one beaker. Okay, in this beaker, first we are going to take, see, this is your platinum wire. Okay, this is your platinum wire. Now we are going to take sparingly soluble salt of same metal. Okay, so what we are going to do, we are taking Hg here. Okay, we are taking mercury here, and the paste of this mercury chloride Hg2Cl2 will apply it onto this platinum electrode. So we have taken a metal whose sparingly soluble salt we have to take. So we have taken Hg here, and its sparingly soluble salt Hg2Cl2 paste here on this platinum wire. On top of this Hg, this mercury, what we are going to do, we are going to take the KCl solution on top of it. This is your KCl solution. So now if you see, your Hg2Cl2 and your KCl both are having same anions, that is your Cl negative. So this way we construct metal insoluble metal salt electrode. Okay, so this is one example of your this type of electrode. Now what about the reaction on this electrode? Here Hg2 positive takes two electrons and changes to 2Hg. Okay, now this will be in liquid state, that you always have to remember, mercury is in liquid state here. Next is your Hg2Cl2 paste, which we have taken, that will also show reaction as Hg2, 2 positive plus 2 Cl negative. If we take out the net cell reaction, then it will be like Hg2Cl2. Okay, we have taken the paste of it, so it is basically a solid state, plus 2 electrons changing to 2Hg, which is in liquid state, plus 2Cl negative. This is your net cell reaction. So this is your third type of electrode. Okay, so now we are going to discuss about cells. What are cells? So cells are basically the systems in which maybe two electrodes are dipped in a solution or maybe two electrodes are dipped in two different solutions two different solutions and they are connected. Okay. So this is how your cells could be formed, right? After that, what are its types? Now the types of cells. It could be of two types. Okay. One could be your electrolytic and second could be your electrochemical, or you can say galvanic cell. Okay, so these are the types. So first we are going to discuss about the electrolytic cells. In electrolytic cells, what we do for a non-spontaneous reaction, okay, non-spontaneous reactions are those which do not happen on their own. They require some kind of driving force. So what we do in case of those non-spontaneous reaction, we provide some electrical energy. Okay, and that electrical energy drives your chemical reaction. Okay, that electrical energy is used to carry out your chemical reaction. So basically we are converting electrical energy to chemical one. Okay, we are going to understand it better with the help of an example. So for example, suppose I have taken one beaker here, okay, and in that beaker I have taken NaCl solution. So this is my electrolytic solution of NaCl. Now what I'm going to do is I'll put one anode and one cathode, okay, and I'll supply electrical energy. Okay, so what happens, suppose this is my anode, this is my anode and this is my cathode. So two different types of reactions will be taking place at anode and cathode. At anode your oxidation will take place and at cathode reduction will take place. So before starting out with the reactions on anode and cathode, I will quickly specify about the oxidation and reduction, how to know that whether the reaction taking place is oxidation one or reduction one. So if there is loss of electron in a reaction, then the reaction is oxidation. So if there is gain of electron, then it is reduction. Second point, if there is gain of oxygen, then it is oxidation. If there is gain of hydrogen, then it is your reduction. If there is increase in the oxidation state, then it is your oxidation. If there is decrease in the oxidation state, then it is reduction. One more point, if there is loss of hydrogen, then it is oxidation. If there is gain of hydrogen, then it is reduction. So these are the points, and using them you can find out whether the reaction which you are seeing is your oxidation one or reduction one. So now we'll move on to the reactions on anode and cathode. At anode, obviously oxidation will take place, okay. Always oxidation takes place at anode, okay, star mark this point, and reduction takes place at cathode. So at anode, what will happen? 2Cl negative will change to Cl2 plus 2 electrons. And at cathode, reduction takes place. Okay, so what will happen? 2Na positive, okay, plus 2 electrons will give 2Na. I have already balanced these equations, okay. I have multiplied this equation with 2, okay. So net cell reaction will be See, two electrons and two electrons will cancel out, and net cell reaction will be 2 Na positive plus 2 Cl negative will give 2 Na plus Cl2 gas. Okay, so this will be your net cell reaction, and this is your type of electrolytic cell, right? So next type of cell is your electrochemical cell. Also called as galvanic cell or your voltaic cell. So this is your second type of cell. In this type of cell, we used to take spontaneous reaction. What we do, we try to harness the energy of the spontaneous reactions. So basically, spontaneous reactions are those which happen on their own. They need only a little bit of initiation. After that, they go on their own. They do not require any driving force. So what we do, we try to harness that energy of the spontaneous reaction. So examples are your Daniell cell or your dry cell. Okay, so now we are going to discuss about galvanic cells in detail. So before starting galvanic cells, I'll give you a brief history about how we reached on making galvanic cells. So suppose this is your beaker and we have taken a copper sulfate solution, and then if we dip a zinc rod, okay, what we observed, this was the first observation which was made, this was the first setup which was made. So what were the observations? The observations were that this zinc rod, this corroded over time. So what happened, this zinc rod, okay, this zinc rod was disappearing. Okay, First observation was zinc rod was disappearing. Second was that the solution of copper sulfate is blue colored, right? This blue color turns colorless, right? We also observed some reddish brown precipitates over here, okay? And the temperature of solution was increasing. So it was an exothermic reaction, okay? Because temperature was increasing, that means there was some reaction going on and we could harness that energy. So what conclusions were made? Conclusions were made that definitely that zinc was changing its oxidation state to zinc Zn2 positive, giving out 2 electrons, and copper 2 positive was taking 2 electrons and changing to copper. That's why the reddish brown precipitates were observed. Also, the reaction is spontaneous. As we can see, we have not provided any driving force for the reaction. It is happening on its own, right? Hence, release in energy was observed. So what happens? This was your direct redox reaction in which reduction and as well as oxidation was taking place in a single pot. So what we did, we tried to harness that energy of this type of spontaneous reaction. So then we made a type of galvanic cell like this. What we did, we took two beakers so that we can separate anode and cathode. So what we did, we took zinc sulfate solution here and dipped a zinc rod in it. Okay, and we took a copper sulfate solution here and dipped a copper rod in it. This is your zinc rod and this is your copper rod. Okay, after that we connected them. Okay, and what we saw, that in this direction current was flowing. Okay, so definitely the movement of electrons was from here to here. okay, two electrons were moving because Zn changes to Zn2 positive, we know that. So two electrons from here were traveling from here for every Zn to Zn2 positive reaction, right? So after some time the reaction stopped. So what we did, in order to maintain the electrical neutrality, what we did, we made a salt bridge here. We'll discuss about the salt bridge in detail just after few minutes. Okay, so what happened, we made this inverted U-shaped salt bridge. Okay, so for the salt bridge, you know that what is the salt bridge. Salt bridge is basically your inverted U-shaped tube, right? So in this setup we have seen that these two electrons are flowing from here to here. So definitely this electrode is your negative electrode, right? And this is going to be your positive electrode, right? So now we'll discuss about the salt bridge. This is inverted U-shaped tube. In this tube, we fill an inert electrolyte. It could be your KNO3, K2SO4, NH4, NO3, NH4Cl, etc. So what we do, we take any of these in agar-agar or gelatin. Agar-agar or gelatin to make a paste of it so that they are not released very fastly into the solutions. They are going into the solution very slowly, okay, in order to maintain the neutrality of the solutions. So this is basically what about your salt bridge, right? So now we'll discuss about the properties of salt bridge. First property of salt bridge is to maintain the electrical neutrality. Second is to maintain liquid junction potential. Liquid junction potential, and third, it completes the circuit. Now, what is meant by this liquid junction potential? Suppose if I am taking this beaker and I have zinc sulfate solution here and copper sulfate solution here separated by a semi-permeable membrane. So what happens, this semi-permeable membrane will only allow the solvent to pass through it and the ions will not pass through it. So what happens, after some time positive charge will be developed here because it is continuously losing two electrons, and negative charge will be developed here because it is constantly taking those electrons. Okay, so what happens, this potential is developed across their junction. This is known as a liquid junction potential. So it helps to maintain that liquid junction potential. Sorry, not maintain, prevent. It prevents the formation of this liquid junction potential by providing its ions to both the solutions. So what we need to take care while making this salt bridge is that the inert electrolyte which we are taking, in that inert electrolyte the mobility of cation and anion should be same in the electrolyte. For example, if we are taking KCl solution, KCl in agar-agar or gelatin, then the mobility of K positive and mobility of Cl negative should be same in those electrolytes, okay? So this is all about your salt bridge. Now what about the reactions on cathode and anode? So at anode, again reaction will be Zn changes to Zn2 positive plus 2 electrons. At cathode, reduction will take place. That is, copper 2 positive will take up these 2 electrons and change to copper solid. Net cell reaction will be 2 electrons will cancel out. Okay, and Zn plus Cu 2 positive will give Zn 2 positive plus copper. So this is your net cell reaction of this type of galvanic cell. So I think that's it for this video. From next video, we'll cover some more topics like Faraday's laws and conductance and its various formulas derived from that conductance formula. Okay, so I think that's it for this video. Thank you so much for watching.